Let's say that you want to exercise. So you make a plan, you get ready. Day one, you look outside and it's rainy, it's cold. So you're like, you know what? It's kind of cold outside. I'll wait until tomorrow. The next day, you feel a little bit sick. So you're like, you know what? I'm not feeling my best. I'm gonna wait until tomorrow. Next day, you're like, well, it's a holiday, you know, family and all. So, you know, I'll go tomorrow. A month later, your buddy asks you, how's your workout going? And you're like, you know what? I haven't really done much since I've been busy and, you know, the holidays, family and all, and I got like super sick. So I think I'm gonna start New Year's. On the other hand, you want to exercise. It's important to you. So first day is rainy, it's cold, it doesn't matter. You put on your jacket and you do your thing. Second day, you feel a little bit sick, but you're like, you know what? 30 minutes, we'll get it done. Third day, it's a holiday, so you say, I better get this done in the morning before my family comes and I get busy. A month later, you're faster, you're stronger than you were before. See, this is what is called being reactive versus being proactive. A person who is reactive is easily affected by the things outside of them. A person who is proactive knows that their behaviors and actions are a product of their decisions and not the conditions. Proactive people are driven by values, in this case being healthy. Reactive people are controlled by their emotions and conditions. For example, let's look at their language. Someone who is reactive tends to use words like, I have to, I can't, that makes me so mad. On the other hand, someone who is proactive uses words like, I choose, I prefer, I will, I rather. Notice how the language of a proactive person has much more control than the language of a reactive person, which lacks control. For example, a person who says, that makes me so mad, is giving up control to the thing that upsets them. On the other hand, a person who says, I'd rather not get mad at that, takes the control away from that situation, and he becomes in charge of his response. Okay, we've talked about the difference between proactive and reactive. Now, how do we become more proactive and less reactive? First is to separate what you can control, things under your influence, and what you cannot control. Stephen Covey refers to them as the circle of influence and circle of concern. A typical reactive person has their circle of concern much larger than the circle of influence. As we become more proactive, we focus on the things that we can control, increasing the size of our circle of influence. At the same time, we start letting go of the things we cannot control, shrinking down our circle of concern. Second, the word proactive comes from two words, active, which means doing something, and pro, meaning before. This means that you are ready and active before something happens to you. Let's think about the first example. You didn't really know that it was gonna be raining and cold or that you would get sick. But by understanding beforehand that you can choose your actions, not based on the conditions, but your values, you won't be as affected. Also, being physically proactive makes your circle of influence become larger. For example, looking at the forecast and choosing your workouts accordingly, for example, can eliminate those issues from your circle of concern, making it smaller, and move them to your circle of influence, making it larger. So habit number one, be proactive. Imagine you are at a funeral 18 months from now, and your loved ones are there. They're sad. And you walk up to the casket to see who passed away, and it's you. Now, as crazy as this scenario is, think about your family. Think about your friends, your co-workers. What would they say about you? Most importantly, what would you say about yourself? How would you want to be remembered? If you want to be remembered as someone who made a positive impact on others, are you doing the things that are making that happen? By starting with a clear picture of where you're going, your end destination, you will have a better understanding of where you are, and it'll make it easier to take the steps in the right direction. Like Covey says, things are created twice, first in the mind, then in the physical reality. So habit number two, begin with the end in mind. What if I ask you, what are the most important things to you? Most people would say family, health, achieving your goals, or your purpose in life. You wouldn't say go to the bar on the weekends, watching TV, or being on Facebook all day. But what is the reality? There's a huge gap between what people say they want and what they actually do. How many people do you know spend more time on social media than working on achieving their goals? More time watching TV than planning their nutrition? This is what psychologists call cognitive dissonance. This is the discomfort that people experience when they perform actions that contradict their values. So habit number 3 is put first things first. Let's say that you have a YouTube channel with similar goals as this one. And I check out your channel and I'm like, huh, I like this guy. He is someone that more people should see. So I share you with my audience. Now you have thousands of people checking out your channel. And then you say, who is this guy? So you check out my channel. And you're like, I like this dude. I'll share him with my audience. Now I got thousands of people checking out my channel. This is what Stephen Covey calls a win-win. In order for you to win, someone else does not have to lose. Also, a person who seeks to create win-win situations with others is perceived to be a leader, because he is always looking to benefit everyone, not just himself. So habit number 4 is think win-win. Habit number 5, seek first to understand, then to be understood. This sounds simple, but it is extremely important. How many times have you seen someone rushing to fix other people's problems with good advice without even understanding the problem first? Or a parent, for example, when their kid tells them that they don't like school. Instead of trying to understand why and working from there, oftentimes they say, "What are you talking about? School is good for you. You just have to apply yourself." Let's think about it in an influence perspective. Would you listen to someone who just tells you what to do, or someone who understands your position and suggests an idea based on that? This is extremely important, especially when it comes to business. If you don't try to understand your clients, audience, or customers, it'll be more difficult for you to please your market. So habit number 5 is to seek first to understand, then to be understood. Habit number 6, synergize. Let's think about Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak. Wozniak was the technical guy who created the first Apple computer, which he never intended to sell. Jobs suggested they should sell it. Synergy means that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Jobs had a talent for marketing. Wozniak had a talent for computers. Both of those talents separated wouldn't have accomplished as much as they did together. For those who don't know, they were the founders of Apple, one of the largest technology companies in the world. Of course, you cannot achieve synergy with everyone, but you should always be on the lookout for it. Habit number 7, sharpen the saw. Stephen Covey gives us a great example. There's this dude sawing down a tree. He was tired. His neighbor goes up to him and says, "You should take a break and sharpen the saw." And the guy responds, "Dude, I don't have time for that. I'm too busy sawing." The last habit is all about preserving and enhancing the biggest asset that you have, you. This habit makes all the other habits achievable. If you want to become effective, you have to sharpen yourself. So habit number 7 is sharpen the saw. And those are the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey.